Although it is a composite of many different engagements, it is representative of several actual conflicts fought in the Mekong Delta during this period. The date was January 31st, 1968. The Vietnamese Lunar New Year's holiday of Tet was beginning, and the entire country was preparing for the traditional celebration. But for the sailors on board the PBRs, it was business as usual, and that business was hunting for the elusive Viet Cong. The sailors' attitude was positive, almost cocksure, said the 29-year-old captain of one PBR. When we catch the Viet Cong on water, he's in our element. His is the dark and the jungle. If he ventures into ours, we'll get him. Just as on any other patrol, the main activity of the PBRs on this day was stopping and searching local sampans for enemy contraband. Operations like these had made the PBR patrol successful at choking off the flow of Viet Cong supplies up until now. Crew members developed an eye for detail that helped them choose the boats they would search. Said one, "First thing you look at is a man's hands and feet. If the nails are cracked, then he's probably a fisherman. If his hands and feet are in good shape, you know he's been wearing boots and carrying a rifle instead of working with his hands. So he's either a deserter, draft dodger, or VC. These searches were always tense for the PBR crewmen. They never knew which one might explode into a sudden firefight with the hidden enemy. This time they were lucky. No Viet Cong soldiers or supplies lurked inside this sampan. With the gift of chewing gum, the boat was sent on its way and the PBRs resumed their trek upriver. As the day wore on, the tropical heat and humidity became stifling. The boredom of the long patrol mixed with the ever-present threat of danger to create a unique kind of tension, one that could wear out a crewman's nerves as well as his body. On this day, that tension was even worse than normal. Boat traffic was unusually light, as if the local population knew something was about to happen. The PBR crews could almost feel the enemy watching and waiting on the banks of the river. Suddenly, in the vicinity of a local village on a branch of the Mekong, all hell broke loose. A hail of recoilless rifle, rocket-propelled grenade, and machine gun fire erupted from the banks of the river. The PBRs accelerated to their full speed of 30 knots and let loose with their own armament. But the enemy fire was too intense to deal with on their own. As one PBR crewman put it, ambushes were a way of life on the Mekong. But this was no usual Viet Cong ambush. It was a full-scale attack in battalion strength. The PBRs fought back for as long as they dared. Then they turned away toward the safer waters in the middle of the channel. At the first sign of trouble, the PBRs had radioed for help.
Roger, wing 24, Mr. Silver and out.
Back on the mothership, their urgent cry for assistance had brought immediate action. The two Navy-manned UH-1 Seawolf helicopters based on board were scrambled for takeoff. Designed to support the PBRs during just such emergencies, the Seawolves could be airborne at virtually a moment's notice. Within minutes, they were speeding toward the battle. Meanwhile, the hard-pressed PBRs were fighting back as best they could. Communicating directly with the Seawolves, the PBRs guided them to the main concentrations of the Viet Cong. Using their fixed and door-mounted machine guns, the Sea Wolves made their first passes at the enemy strong points. .76 millimeter rocket fire lashed out to pulverize the Viet Cong. By now, more PBRs had rushed to reinforce the original patrol. As the battle raged into the night, it became obvious that it would take more than the PBRs and the Sea Wolves to drive the Viet Cong away this time. It was now clear that the enemy forces engaged in this battle were only a small part of a huge countrywide offensive that was hitting targets all across South Vietnam. Not long before, the U.S. High Command had assured the American public that the Viet Cong were on the verge of defeat, that victory was at hand. The Tet Offensive proved them wrong and irrevocably changed the American public's perception of the war. The next morning found more help coming in the form of the Mobile Riverine Forces attached to Operation Game Warden. These were Army troops embarked on Navy landing craft that could be dispatched upriver to attack enemy infantry concentrations when the situation called for it. As they boarded their craft, these troops knew they were in for stiffer resistance than they had ever encountered before. They had heard the news about the enemy offensive, and now they were heading right into the teeth of the battle. The flotilla of armored troop carriers was escorted by heavily armed monitors to provide fire support. At the battle scene, the monitors opened up with 81 millimeter mortars and 40 millimeter cannon, smashing the enemy at the point of attack. The troop carriers moved in to land U.S. forces on the flanks of the Viet Cong. Meanwhile, the PBRs used their extremely shallow draft to move in close to shore and soften up enemy positions along the riverbank that the monitors could not deal with effectively. The Sea Wolves, too, continued the assault from the air. Landing on either side of the Viet Cong, the ground troops caught them in the jaws of a classic pincer movement. The intensity of the battle grew as more and more U.S. firepower was brought to bear. Slowly, the tide turned, and the enemy was driven back from their positions. The PBRs and Sea Wolves were now used to cut off the Viet Cong's escape routes along the canals behind the enemy positions. Finally, after hours of hard fighting, the battle was won. Overwhelmed, the guerrilla forces were forced to either flee or surrender. The Tet Offensive would continue for 72 days. Militarily, the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese were defeated. Politically, however, the results were far more ambiguous. But for the PBRs and their crews, this action in the Mekong Delta was clear-cut. Though greatly outnumbered, they and the Sea Wolves had held the enemy at bay until superior U.S. forces could be brought to bear. The tiny PBRs and their crews had lived up to the unofficial name that had been coined to describe them from the initials PBR. Proud, brave, reliable.